Available now from Graphic Audio.
There's two banks in Dodge City. Both are full of cattlemen's money, according to what I've heard. We hit them both, hard and fast, right after they open. Make examples out of them that tries to fight back. Gun them down like ducks coming off a pond.
I hear Dodge can be a tough town, Bill. Maybe you hadn't ought to figure that'll be that easy.
You done turned yellow dog on us, Curly. I got no use for a damn coward.
You ain't gonna shoot me, Bill.
You ain't left me no choice, Kirk. I gotta make an example out of you.
We've been together since...
Any more you sons of bitches got anything to say?
My name's Wyatt Earp. I'm the city marshal. Just curious as to why you're carrying so many guns at this hour.
Smoke Jensen. I was headed down to check on a herd I brought in yesterday. As to the guns, I rarely go anywhere without them. Old habit, I reckon.
It's called fate. Some men have got the fates dead set against them. Smoke is one. Most other men can ride all the way from California to Dodge City without having so much as a loose horseshoe. Smoke don't hardly ever get that kind of peace. It's the hand of fate that keeps guiding them toward the fight.
Welcome to Dodge, Mr. Bloody Bill Anderson. We've got a little surprise waiting for you.
Saddle up and ride into adventure with Smoke Jensen, the Mountain Man 22. Pride of the Mountain Man. Available now in Graphic Audio.
Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 23, Sacred Ground. Narrated by Nanette Savard. Performances by Colleen Delany, Danny Gavigan, Michael Glenn, Richard Rowan, Scott McCormick, Mort Shelby, Thomas Keegan, Joseph Thornhill, Christopher Graybill, and James Konicek.
It's been my experience that the motives of private industry and those of the public don't usually make for good bedfellows.
Anya Creed reclined a bit farther back into the deep chocolate leather of her armchair and waited for the man sitting across from her to respond. Derek Wainman took a sip from a steaming mug of coffee before setting it on the frosted glass table.
That's a pretty narrow way to look at things. After all, it's in our best interest to work with the public to make sure they don't feel slighted. These are, after all, potential customers.
Anya considered the map in front of her. This time of year, most of the Northwest Territories of Canada was frozen. The Arctic tundra was a mass of brittle green amid the snows and winds. She shivered just thinking about how cold it was out there.
It couldn't be worse than Antarctica, could it?
She smiled at the memories of that adventure, and then noticed Derek watching.
You okay?
The cold weather makes me reminisce about the other times I've been in the thick of it.
That's been quite often, hasn't it?
Anya looked at him. He smirked and waved his hand.
Don't be so concerned. We take great pains to find out all we can about people we might be interested in working with. And there's never been anything that the right amount of money can't purchase. Information especially.
Anya smiled. She was 100% positive there was at least one small nugget of intelligence that their money hadn't been able to procure. The presence of the sword that she always carried with her.
That's a curious grin.
Anya made her face expressionless.
This guy doesn't miss a thing. I'll have to remember that. How successful has the mining operation been at Akati?
By all accounts, incredibly so. It's expected to yield 500 million Canadian dollars a year for the next 25 years. Who would have thought that the Earth could have such a repository of untapped wealth?
I might have, but then I dig for a living.
You like getting dirty.
Anya watched his face for any signs that he was tossing innuendo around, but he seemed to be serious.
Getting dirty comes with the territory. It can't be helped. And it's only when you're truly down in the thick of it that you find the most precious treasures. So, yes, I like getting dirty.
Where were you before this?
I thought you had a complete workup on my recent activities.
We do.
So what, you want to see if I lie about my whereabouts?
Calm down. It was just a friendly question.
Anya looked at the map again. Frozen lakes, frozen rivers, frozen everything. It would be a damned cold jaunt, she knew that.
Why now?
Excuse me?
Wouldn't it make more sense to start something like this in the spring?
We're hoping that by the time you get to the site and extricate everything that needs extricating, it will be spring, and just in time for us to start our real work.
Ah, the real work.
Derek leaned forward.
Anya, please make no mistake. While we're committed to helping the Inuit preserve whatever sacred ground they have in this location, our primary emphasis is on profit. We're a private corporation, and as such, driven by the ever-present bottom line.
Hence my original statement about private and public interests not intersecting.
We can help each other.
How so?
By you agreeing to come on board and assist the Inuit elders with their research, we gain a certain degree of sympathy for our corporation. Our public image looks better than if we simply steamrolled in and took what we wanted from the land with little regard to its history.
Even though that's exactly what you want to do anyway?
You don't strike me as being naive, Anya.
I'm not.
So, you understand the function of our meeting and your employment with us on this matter?
I'm coming in as a contractor.
But you work for us.
I gathered as much.
For which you'll be paid quite handsomely. Far more than you make hosting that little show on television.
Actually, Chasing History's Monsters does pretty well in the ratings.
Only when your co-host manages to have a well-timed wardrobe malfunction.
Granted.
Anya folded up the map.
How long has this land belonged to this tribe of Inuit?
Almost 1,000 years.
You were able to trace it back that far?
Yeah, it was part of what we had to do in order to make sure that the government was satisfied. We did as much as possible to benefit the tribe.
And what have you paid the Inuit?
Far more than the land is worth. But I'm not exactly at liberty to disclose the exact number we eventually settled upon.
Still, you'll inevitably extract far more than that if your estimates are correct, right?
Of course. It wouldn't have been a good investment otherwise. And we most certainly are not in the business of throwing money away.
This dig site was a condition of the purchase?
The elders insisted on it. They claim a portion of the land, which happens to be exactly where our scientists tell us that the richest veins of kimberlite lie, is an ancient burial site. It has to be moved to a new area that has been consecrated.
Kimberlite indicates the presence of diamonds, right?
Yes. It's a type of potassic volcanic rock. It occurs naturally in pipes, or long vertical structures that have the potential to contain diamonds. Our scientists tell me that kimberlite is formed deep within the Earth's mantle, probably between 90 and 300 miles deep.
Journey to the center of the Earth.
All for a girl's best friend. Yes.
So why bring me in?
We need you to confirm when the land is free of relics and assorted Inuit history. If we didn't have you in there, the Inuit could hold things up indefinitely and claim there was still any number of items that had to be extracted or moved. It could delay our operations for years. And we are definitely in the realm of time is money.
I see.
Your job is to get in there, get friendly with the Inuit elders, and help them do what they need to do. Move their burial site, make sure there aren't any relics that need to be dug up and preserved. Do whatever it takes, but within 4 weeks, we want that land free of any Inuit association. Because at the first sign of a thaw, as much as we get up in these parts, we're coming in with the drills.
And at that point, there won't be any second chance for the Inuit.
None. Once you give us the word, or if the 4 weeks expire first, we're coming in. I don't think anyone could argue we haven't been more than patient.
I'm sure someone could.
True. People are always able to complain when they're not spending $1 billion of their own money.
This is a billion-dollar operation?
I never said that, if anyone asks.
All right, then.
Derek finished his coffee and set the empty mug back down on the table.
Do you have any other questions?
My payment?
We wired the first installment directly into your bank account this morning, prior to this meeting.
You're awfully confident that I'd take the assignment.
We make a habit of knowing as much as possible about who we deal with ahead of time. I've read all of your files and information. I've watched you for a while, on television even. I know you can't resist the pull of a new dig. It's too deeply ingrained in your spirit.
You calling me an addict?
Well, are you?
Sure feels that way sometimes.
You say that with a degree of sadness.
Not really. I tend to live a lot of my life locked in the past. Memories of what I've done overlap with the memories I dig through on an almost daily basis. Sometimes it's impossible to see the future.
Well, I guess I can understand that to some extent.
Only some?
Well, I've never been on an archaeological excursion.
Make some time. Come and join me on this one.
I hate the cold.
You're kidding.
I wish. It's the one part of this job that I struggle with on a constant basis. If there was any way to do this from the warm beaches of Fiji, I'd be a much happier man.
I guess not, though, huh?
No.
The rest of my payment will be transferred in 4 weeks?
Or upon completion of the job, whichever comes first. If you finish in 2 weeks, you get a 50% bonus.
Mighty generous of you.
Not my decision, actually, but I'll pass it on. Remember what I told you, that we're in the time-is-money realm. My bosses want this thing to move ahead quickly. I hope we can count on you.
If you had any doubts, I wouldn't be here, would I?
Nope.
All right. I'm in.
Excellent.
I'll need a week to get my stuff together and gather up what I'll need to make sure I've got the necessary tools.
We leave right now.
Excuse me?
Whatever you need, we can pick up on the way. Inuvik has a number of good locations to pick up supplies.
I wasn't planning on this happening so quickly.
But I know for a fact that you always manage to land on your feet, even in the most surprising situations.
I don't like working this way.
Consider it a show of good faith. You indulge us in this little matter, and we'll make sure you have whatever it is that you need.
Okay. But if I don't have my supplies, I walk away and keep the advance.
Done.
Anya looked at him for a long moment and then nodded.
All right.
Welcome aboard.
Derek held out his hand.
I hope I meet your expectations accordingly.
I know you will.
He guided her out of the hotel lobby and toward the front door. Outside, amid the swirling snow, Anya could just make out the blackened windows of a big SUV. Exhaust issued from the tailpipe.
Been waiting long?
Things tend to freeze up a lot faster up here. We keep engines going when we can.
How environmentally friendly of you.
Look, Anya, I know you said you tend to live in the past.
But...
keep the future in mind. 4 weeks, to be exact. That's the maximum amount of time I can allot you in this assignment. Anything more and we come in. And then all of that history, whatever happens to be left, gets ground up under our drill bits.
On the ride to Inuvik, Anya prayed that the heavy tires on the SUV didn't blow out as they drove over portions of highway, sections of hard gravel, and even dirt road. She thanked the inventor of shock absorbers many times during the ride, but even still, when she finally arrived at the Inuvik Welcome Center, Anya found herself massaging her buttocks. Derek didn't look as if he'd fared much better.
The last time I rode up here, it wasn't that bad.
Maybe you guys could chip in for a highway reconstruction project. Throw a few million at them to pave the entire expanse for the sake of butts everywhere.
I'll talk to my superiors about it.
Anya glanced around. Thick snow coated every exterior surface. Her breath seemed to stain the air in front of her face and then drop to the ground already frozen.
Just how cold is it?
Right now?
Yeah.
About 30 below.
I had to ask.
Maybe we should get inside.
Anya glanced back at their driver, who seemed to be paying more attention to the vehicle than to them. She turned and followed Derek inside the welcome center. As Anya passed a display showing a map of the area, she stopped Derek.
Will we be working out of the town here?
Nope. This is just our waypoint. We've got a temporary camp set up closer to the drill site. I mean, the future drill site.
Right now, it's still sacred Inuit land.
Araktak, to be accurate. They've been around these parts for...
1,000 years, you told me. I'm sure they've got an incredible history.
I wouldn't know. They're not one of the larger tribes in the area. They've remained incredibly independent, despite the efforts to unify the smaller tribes into a larger one for the purposes of government help and education, I don't think there's a lot known about them.
Interesting.
It might be another coup for you.
What's that supposed to mean?
I know you've had a number of interesting discoveries in your time. Things you've had the good fortune to stumble across before anyone else. Perhaps the Araktak can be another jewel in your crown of accomplishments.
Maybe. I wouldn't be looking at it as a way of one-upping my peers, though.
Of course not. It would just be another one of those nice things that happen to people.
Anya frowned as she watched him walk away.
What's his deal?
She'd noticed he didn't wear a wedding ring, and although he seemed young, she could see the first streaks of gray hair at his temple. She estimated he was probably around 40. He seemed in good shape, and despite his avowed hatred of the cold, it hadn't seemed to bother him too much when they'd been outside.
Maybe he's used to it by now.
The display told Anya that Inuvik was small, only about 300 people in total. It hadn't been much of anything before 1979, but now it functioned as something of a gateway to the Mackenzie River and beyond into the Beaufort Delta, which bordered the Arctic Ocean. Derek reappeared beside her.
The main function of the town is to act as a staging area for truckers to haul loads up to the refinery projects on the Delta. Once the river freezes, they actually drive across the frozen water to reach their destinations.
You're not serious.
I absolutely am.
You'd never get me driving over ice like that. One wrong move if it's not thick enough and you could go right through and never be seen again.
Very true. Many truckers have lost their lives to it. But then again, up here, it's the only way to get things done.
I hope you're not telling me that the drill site is located anywhere near this frozen river.
Would you want to back out if it was?
Very possibly.
And what about all that money?
Money's nice. Living is nicer.
Well, don't worry about it too much. The drill site lies inland. Lucky for you.
Thank God for small favors.
You don't strike me as someone afraid of much, especially a little frozen river.
The frozen river doesn't scare me, but falling through the ice and drowning does.
I wouldn't worry about drowning. The moment you hit the ice water, you'd probably go into cardiac arrest anyway.
Oh, well, that's a relief. Thanks.
My pleasure. Anything else you want to see here?
You're finished with whatever we came in for?
Well, I simply wanted to introduce you to the town. Figured it would be a nice way to ease you into things.
Ease me into things? You're just full of contradictions, aren't you?
How do you figure that?
Because you basically kidnapped me earlier at our meeting, and now you're talking about slowing down.
Well, I was sort of under orders not to let you back out of the arrangement. Not to give you an opportunity to say no.
I see.
But now that you're here in town, well, it's different, isn't it?
If you say so.
Derek checked his watch.
We're not going any farther today anyway.
So we'll stay here tonight?
Yep. Gotta set up with reservations at the town inn. It's just down the street.
And what time will we be on the road tomorrow?
Early as we can.
All right. Let's go.
As they drove through the town, Anya spotted a number of kids out walking with their parents.
It amazes me what human beings can put up with.
Well, if you don't have the option to move elsewhere, you simply adapt. I think it's our greatest strength. It's what will someday enable us to colonize another planet.
And hopefully treat it better than this one.
Ouch.
Don't worry. I won't get preachy on you.
Thanks. It's not like I don't care for the planet. It's just that I've had to reconcile my work with my beliefs.
And the bank account won, huh?
Sure did.
I'm sure you must sleep easy at night.
I sleep well knowing I've taken care of my children.
Anya looked back from the window.
You have kids?
Two of them. A boy and a girl. 8 and 10. Great kids. They live in California with their mother. We're divorced. She didn't approve of my line of work.
What does she do?
She's an advocate for Greenpeace.
Wow. How the hell did you two even get together in the first place?
I wasn't always a corporate lackey. Before I sold my soul, I was an environmental lobbyist on Capitol Hill. We met at a luncheon or a dinner or something in Washington. We were young, idealistic. We had plans at one point to start a utopian community in the Canadian wilderness.
So what happened?
I came north to scout a location and fell in with the mining corporation. They appreciated my zeal for causes. I thought Canada would be the best place to raise our children, but it turns out my wife was still a bit of a patriot. She insisted that we raise the kids in the States.
And around that time, the corporation got their hooks into you, is that about right?
Yeah. They offered me a public relations job helping them get government approval for a project that didn't pan out. I figured they'd let me go once it became obvious that we were digging in the wrong location, but that didn't happen. Instead, in recognition of my efforts on their behalf, they promoted me and gave me a big pay raise. Now I get to spend lavishly on my kids, much to the dismay of their mother. If anything happens to me, they're set for life.
I suppose that's what it's all about, huh?
Anything for my kids, absolutely.
The SUV came to a stop in front of a long, squat building with a wooden sign twisting about in the stiff wind. Anya could just make out the name of the inn as the Breton.
This is where we're staying?
I imagine it will seem quite luxurious, especially once you see the dig site.
I've stayed in worse.
Derek opened the door, and a brisk gust of wind greeted them.
Godwin will see to our bags. Let's get inside.
Anya glanced at the driver. Godwin was an unusual name. She hadn't actually been introduced to the man, but she shrugged and followed Derek inside. He pushed through the heavy door and into a wall of heat.
Oh, toasty in here.
The man behind the counter smiled.
Welcome, folks.
You've got some reservations for us, I believe. They should be under the name Mr. Smith.
Anya cocked an eyebrow. Derek waved her off and then turned back to the man.
Should be 3 rooms in total.
Yep, got them right here. Not like we'd be full up or nothing. Don't exactly get ourselves a bumper crop of tourists this time of year.
We'll just be here for the night.
Fair enough, just sign in. It's cash only, mind you, so if you've got anything plastic, there's a bank machine down the road at Terry's trading post.
Cash is fine.
Derek pulled out his wallet and fished out several bills. The man took the money and laid 3 keys down on the counter.
Right, you're all next to each other. Hope you don't mind, it's easier this way.
Derek handed one of the keys to Anya and turned back to the man.
What's a good place to get a meal around here?
We don't have anything fancy.
No, I don't care about fancy, just good.
Well then, you can't do any better than the steakhouse across the street. They do a great porterhouse. Keep a couple of beers on tap as well. It's a fine meal. Finish it off with a single malt and you'll be back in time for a toasty night here in your bed.
Sounds good. Thanks.
Where's your third party?
Godwin came through the door carrying an assortment of traveling bags. He looked even taller and more imposing in the close confines of the inn's reception area. And he didn't seem to smile all that much.
I'll need some clothes, Derek. If you recall, we didn't stop like you promised.
Godwin set down a bag near Anya.
You'll find everything you need in there, Miss Creed.
Anya looked at the bag, and then back at Godwin.
My clothes?
All new. With the equipment you might need for your work. If there's anything else you require, please let me know, and I'll see that you get it as soon as possible.
Is this more of your paid-for information at work, Derek?
Well, guessing your size isn't much of a challenge. We did enough research to know what you need. You'll find it all there.
You must have been incredibly confident that I would agree to work with you.
I was.
Are you ever wrong?
Only about my ex-wife.
Anya allowed herself a small grin.
I'm hungry.
Let's get changed and meet back here in what, 20 minutes?
Sure.
Derek handed the final key to Godwin.
You've secured the vehicle?
Yes, sir.
They walked down the corridor and entered their rooms. Anya took a moment to examine her surroundings. The room was small but functional. A single lamp on the bedside table gave off a warm glow of light. The bed was a double, big enough for one, but not much more.
As if I'd be getting lucky in a town like this.
She threw her bag on the bed and unzipped it. She pulled out 3 heavy sweaters, thermal underwear, fleece pants, lined jeans, turtlenecks, and then a heavy parka, gloves, and a thick woolen hat. Godwin had thoughtfully removed all the tags and stickers that would have marked the clothing as new. Anya couldn't even see where he might have purchased the clothes, but judging by the feel of them, they were expensive and perfectly suited to the environment she'd be operating in. Anya stripped off her clothes and dressed in the thermal underwear, turtleneck, jeans, and sweater before sliding into the parka. She looked at herself in the mirror and decided that the road hadn't made her look like a total mess.
Hi, you've reached Anya Creed. I'm out digging in the dirt somewhere. Leave me a message and I'll call you back once I get home. Time to go.
Back in the lobby, Godwin was already there watching the satellite TV in the corner of the room. He looked up as Anya entered and nodded. Anya did a quick pirouette.
You like?
Everything fits you properly. That's good. Means I did my job well.
Thank you. I was a bit worried when I suddenly found myself employed earlier this afternoon.
Mr. Wainman was quite explicit in his instructions. I would be upset if something didn't fit you properly. Up here in these parts, proper fit isn't a matter of fashion. It's a matter of survival. If your body heat isn't adequately managed, you'll die from exposure.
You sound like you know your way around these parts.
I do. My ancestors have lived in this area for generations. Longer than that, even.
Araktak?
I'm half. My father married outside the family. Didn't go over so well, but then again, the course of true love never did run smooth. Isn't that what they say?
Some of them.
Well, never really belonged to the family. My mother was an outsider, so her blood and mine makes me the same.
They won't take you in as one of their own?
Not the Araktak. They're far too proud to admit a half-breed.
They're lost, then.
Derek came into the reception area.
Oh, I see your clothes fit you well. Excellent job, Godwin.
Thanks.
Everyone hungry, then? Dinner's on me.
Anya glanced at the counterman, but he was engrossed in the television behind the counter.
Not on the company?
We think it's best if we don't advertise the fact that we're interested in this particular area.
But isn't the deal at least somewhat known?
Only by those who need to know. And at this point, it's probably better that we don't let anyone else in on our work. People in these parts are naturally suspicious of outsiders.
Anya glanced at Godwin.
Is that true?
Don't know. I'm an outsider myself.
The restaurant was really not much more than a glorified bar, but the tables and chairs looked comfortable enough. A burly waitress ushered them into a booth and handed them each a menu. Derek glanced at his.
I'd like your porterhouse, cooked medium rare, and a beer.
Make that two.
You wouldn't have any fish, would you?
Nope, no fish.
Well then, make mine medium, please. Thanks.
Anya watched her walk away and then glanced at Godwin.
Wow. Nothing like service with a smile.
I guess I look like a native. A lot of folks up here don't trust the Inuit. And if she can figure out I'm a Araktak, then she'll have even more reason to be suspicious.
Why so?
Like I mentioned earlier, the Araktak are secretive. They've kept to themselves for hundreds of years. No one knows this land like they do, but they don't often grant an audience to outsiders.
So how did your company ever get inroads with them?
Perseverance and Godwin.
I thought you said they wouldn't accept you as one of their own.
They don't. But since I carry my father's name, they had to at least hear me out of respect for his lineage. I acted as the official go-between and got things settled for the company.
And it's one of the reasons why he'll be your constant companion on this venture. The company wants one of its own on the inside while you work. It's not that we don't trust you. It's that we don't fully trust the Araktak.
Why not?
There have been some power shifts in the tribe. Some of the Araktak want to do away with the old traditions and embrace the new millennium. Others want nothing to do with the modern world and wish to retreat back into even more secrecy.
And how does everyone feel about the agreement with the company?
There's been some unpleasantness.
What kind of unpleasantness?
The last representative we sent had a tough time gaining any type of relationship with the Araktak. They sent him back with a broken arm.
Mind here, I thought this wouldn't be dangerous.
It's yet another reason we wanted to work with you, Anya. Our information tells us that you are more than capable of holding your own in the event of unpleasantness.
I suppose you could say that. Although I'd much prefer avoiding conflict, if possible.
As would we. But given the tenuous nature of the situation, it would be wise if you were well prepared for any eventuality.
Is that another reason why you're going along on this, Godwin?
Godwin is here to protect the interests of the company. And in this case, you are most definitely an interest.
Well, I hope you won't have to do anything to protect me.
It's my job to be ready just in case.
What if you need protecting?
That seems unlikely.
Been known to happen, though.
If it happens, then I'll deal with it. But I am much more interested in making sure nothing happens to you or the company's position. It's vital that this goes through.
Anya watched him for another minute before turning her attention to the beer the waitress had just set down in front of her. She took a sip, and before she could set the glass down, something tickled her subconscious. Across from them, she could see two men at the bar taking more than a passing interest in their table. Godwin might just get a chance to show his skills sooner than he'd thought. Anya smiled. At least some action would get her blood moving. Anya took another sip of her beer. The two men at the bar were growing impatient, judging by the way they jostled against the counter. Anya glanced at Godwin.
I think we might be attracting some interest.
Godwin's dark eyes flashed over to the bar.
Sure seems to be.
Friends of yours?
Nope, but it doesn't matter. They apparently think they know me, or know of me. Either way, it could get messy in here.
What are you two talking about?
It seems as though some of Godwin's friends might be looking to join us.
Friends?
It's a loose term. Really depends on how you feel about people who want to break your bones.
Mr. Wainman, there's a chance we might have some trouble here very shortly. Whether we want it or not.
We haven't even eaten dinner yet.
I've found these types rarely have a good sense of timing.
Can you handle it, Godwin?
Most certainly.
Well, I'm not missing out on the fun.
It's not your fight.
It is my prerogative, however. And I need a bit of activity to keep my muscles in shape.
The bigger of the two men came off the bar stool then, his eyes narrowing as he stared at Godwin. Anya figured he must have weighed over 200 pounds, given that even the thick shirt he wore couldn't disguise the mass underneath. He had his huge hands tightly squeezed into fists. Behind him, the smaller man followed, but he was by no means the lesser of the two threats. Anya saw that he kept his right hand tucked in his back pocket.
A knife. It has to be a knife of some sort. Oh, great.
The big man stopped and pointed a finger at Godwin.
You there! You're a Araktak, ain't you?
Part?
Part? You mean you're a bastard, too? What was it? Your mother or your father that couldn't stand to be with his own people?
What business is it of yours?
I don't like Araktak.
I'm sure the feeling is mutual.
The big man edged closer.
I don't like them, because they stole my land from my family.
The Araktak have been in this area for the better part of 1,000 years. How long's your family been here?
Don't matter. They took what didn't belong to them. My family lost everything thanks to that no-good government being all concerned for the Inuit scum.
Well, you have my sympathies if it makes any difference to you at all.
It don't. Because to me, the only good Araktak is a dead Araktak.
Ugh. God should strike down whichever idiot first coined that expression. Only the brainless still use it.
Last I checked, this conversation weren't about you, little lady.
Little lady?
Just keep your pretty mouth shut and you won't get hurt.
Anya rose from the table.
And suppose, just suppose, I feel like opening my mouth. What then?
Then you get it closed.
Anya smiled widely. She could feel her blood coursing through her as her heart pumped harder. She flexed her hands, knowing that her energy was cresting. She glanced back at Godwin, who had moved closer to the edge of the booth seat. She pointed at the smaller of the two men.
Watch out for the blade that guy has in his right back pocket.
Got it.
Anya looked back at the big man.
I'm not going to close my mouth, so I guess you'll just have to do it for me.
Fine by me, you dumb bitch.
As he started forward, Anya jumped. Anya's foot slammed into the side of his chin.
That kick should have knocked him out.
Anya shook off his backhand blow, then dropped and rolled to get some distance.
You think I won't kick a girl's ass? You're about to find out how wrong you are!
Anya fainted with a jab, then drove a sharp right hook into his floating ribs. He still remained annoyingly upright. Anya was briefly aware that Godwin was tangling with the smaller man, handily evading the vicious swipes of his knife. As the big guy came at her again, Anya pivoted on one knee and lashed out with the other leg. He landed on his butt. Anya leaped up and brought her elbow down into his stomach. The air around her stunk with the smell of liquor. She rolled away, but so did her opponent, and got to his feet with surprising quickness for someone of his size.
Now you've made me mad.
Anya grabbed a chair from the closest table. This time he went down and stayed down. Godwin was still working on getting the edge with his attacker. The smaller man was keeping Godwin at bay, but Godwin seemed content to let him wear himself out. When his comrade went down, he made his error. He jerked his arm out in a wider arc than before. Godwin pivoted inside the arc, and drove his elbow deep into the smaller man's solar plexus. Then his hands clamped down on the arm wielding the knife. Godwin stepped back, stooped, and retrieved the knife. He turned it over and frowned.
I haven't seen one like this in a very long time.
What?
Godwin showed it to her. The knife seemed to curve closer to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.